We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Good evening. It's Tuesday, November 13th, 2012, and you're tuned in to Real Talk with Demetrius and AJ. I'm your co-host, Demetrius.
And I'm AJ. Real Talk is our new political show designed to prompt vigorous debate about the challenges confronting our nation.
That's right. No sound bites, no set talking points, and no point of view is inadmissible on this show. Today's topics: America has spoken. Barack Obama gets 4 more years. So what's next for our political future here in America?
We'll see. Otherwise, this is LATalkLive.com, where we are more than just talk.
Later in the show, we'll be having our special guest. You forgot to introduce him. Fabian Nunez, who's the former Speaker of the California State Assembly.
That's right.
I'm going to need you to get it together.
Just ran in here 1 minute ago. Yes, he will be joined by Fabian Nunez. And yes,
this is
going to be
talk.
A good show.
Okay, so the election is over. There's a lot going on in the news. You know what? This today has been very frustrating for me because
why
our mainstream media, you know, with so many problems that's going on politically, so many issues that we have to tackle as a nation. If you turn on the news right now on the mainstream media, what is the big story? General Petraeus and his sex scandal.
I know.
That's all over the news today.
No, it's true.
Why is that? Why are we talking about a sex scandal and not talking about the things and the issues that we need to fix in our country?
Well, if you ask me, who knows what's really going on, but I do think it's questionable timing as well. I mean, we do know that we're days away from where he would have been testifying on what's going on in Libya, what happened in Libya, and all of the findings of their investigation. I'm actually with Dianne Feinstein on this one. Shout out to Dianne Feinstein, who was newly reelected in California in this election as well. She said, whatever, just somebody subpoena him so that he can come in and testify at the end of the day, which is what I'm saying. Who knows what actually happened? That's between him, those people involved, and his wife, and let he who is without sin cast the first stone.
I agree with
that. In the meantime, you know,
we're going to lose some. We're losing somebody that is, you know, has definitely demonstrated his ability, his savvy when it comes to making war plans and strategies and things of that nature. He helped us throughout the Iraq war. He advised the president on how we get out of there, basically. And we lose people all the time to personal scandals like this. And it just seems like the mainstream media is so enamored with that stuff. I think most people, most American citizens, just really don't give a damn about that stuff and would rather we just focus on the issues that are at hand.
Did you hear that John Kerry might actually be asked to replace him, even though supposedly he had his eye on the position of Secretary of State? Did you? There was been talk of that.
Yeah, I heard about that. And John Kerry is a pretty good guy. I think he'll be well fit for the position.
I don't think I'd mind it either. I think he may even be a little bit, who knows what Kerry's going to do, but I want somebody in there who's going to be a lot less loose when it comes to deploying drones. That's what I want. Because I know Petraeus has a reputation for being a little bit an enabler of the extreme war policies that I think are.
You got to understand that our warfare is changing. You know, America is not the only country that has drones now. Warfare is changing more so on a technological standard. And that's just the way things are. Back in the day, you know, like Barack said, we had bayonets and horses. That's
oh,
what we fought.
God, he loved that
that's
line.
What we fought with. But as time progresses, there are more advances technologically, and it's going to allow us to fight wars in a smarter way. I don't see the problem with that. As long as it's being used in a responsible way,
the problem with that. We'll dedicate a show to that, going through the history of military war strategy in the country.
Yeah, but we're going to take a quick break first. But okay. When we get back, we're going to get into, you know, what's next for America now politically, now that Barack Obama has won 4 years
and
again.
It seems like as soon as he got reelected, everything started breaking, didn't it? or maybe they just waited until his reelection for everything that was already looming to come out. Either way, but
well,
we have a lot of stuff.
Either
on
way,
table
we still
with.
Got a lot to handle. We still got a lot of ideas to bring up to try to fix this stuff. So don't go away.
We're talking about that.
Remember that you can follow the discussion and join into the discussion by our Twitter account at Demetrius and AJ. Or you can call in here to the studio, 323-247-7443. We'd love to hear your ideas. Please give us a call.
That's right.
We'll be right back.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and hosts of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
People, it's Jennifer Tapiero from StarCam. You guys might know me from the red carpet, catching up with all the stars, but guess what? We're bringing the red carpet to the radio right out here on LA Talk Live. I'm going live Thursday nights at 6 p.m. We got hot topics, celebrities, and much more. We were featured on Chloe Lamar on E!, Howard Stern, T.I.'s Family Hustle. You know how we do. So check it out on Thursday nights, 6 p.m. All things Hollywood, everything celebrity. StarCam Radio.
StarCam Radio.
StarCam Radio.
Oh yeah, follow us on Twitter at StarCam Radio.
Hi, this is Starla Quarles, and I'm inviting you to join us every Wednesday from 5 to 6 p.m. for a new show right here on LA Talk Live, The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People. Join us as we discuss the topics that are relevant to today's generational leaders. So don't forget to tune in to The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People, every Wednesday from 5 to 6 p.m. right here on latalklive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, and now Stitcher Radio. Or watch and listen directly at latalklive.com. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hi, this is Nick Cordelai Corte inviting you to join me Sundays at 10 a.m. right here on LA Talk Live for our all-new show, People Are Talking. Join us as we offer you a weekly dose of fresh perspectives with in-studio guests, hot topics in the world of politics and pop culture, and the voices of everyday people impacted by the political issues coming to a ballot box near you. So don't forget to tune in to People Are Talking exclusively on latalklive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B, watch us on Ustream.tv, or even catch us under the Radio Flags app under ILATK. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
And welcome back. We are back. We are back. And we are going to get into a discussion about post-election, maybe a little bit of post-election analysis and see what it means for our country. And then later on in the show, we're going to be joined by our special guest, former Speaker of the California State Assembly, Mr. Fabian Nunez. Assembly. California State Assembly.
Yes.
All right. The election is over. We have chosen Barack Obama for another 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
Are you happy about that?
I'm glad that I've forgotten his name already.
Barack Obama?
No.
Oh, Mittimus. Mitt Romney.
I'm glad Romney's not president. I will say that.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm glad he's not either. And shout out to America for choosing the right choice for president. I think
wouldn't go that
Barack
far.
Barack is, well, he's obviously the better choice. He's
the better
than
choice.
Mitt.
The better choice.
For sure.
Of the options that we have available to us, the better, slightly better choice.
Well, listen, that's beside the point. The point is you got to get behind your president. He's your president, whether you like him, whether you dislike him. You know, he is your president. And I think that every American would, I hope, would want this president to succeed.
Absolutely. By the way, just as a side note, people have been seeing in the news that many states after the re-election of Barack Obama have issued petitions for their state to secede from the union.
Are you serious?
Yes. Richard, you heard about this, didn't you? Crazy.
What state? Wait, what states are these?
North Carolina.
North Carolina. Oh, my. No,
I'm
going to have to call my people in North Carolina.
South Carolina. Like all those states that you, I don't want to say. Actually, New York's on the list, too. Which
no way. Obama won New York.
I know, but there's somebody in the state that's calling. It's Tennessee. I'm trying to remember.
It's just sour grapes.
But
it's just sour grapes. They'll be fine. They're pouting. Those who are upset that Obama won, they're pouting.
We're going a little too far. I would say to all of you people who are out there who are part of this petition movement, rather than that, why don't you get involved in the political discussion and help us solve some of these problems and actually have a dialogue and call your congressman, call your representative. Don't just It's just, come on.
Well, like I said, it's sour grapes. I think what's happening is, you know, especially the Republicans, you know, they're very upset about this loss, and to the point where they're pointing the finger at each other now. Mm-hmm. You know, it's Karl Rove's fault. It's Rush Limbaugh's fault. It's Mitt Romney's fault. You know, somebody has to take the blame for this loss.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, they don't understand that it's their message. Their message is the reason they lost. People are thinking more so in a modern way now. We're not trying to relive the 60s and 70s things the way things were back then. This is a new generation of people. There's a culture war in the United States.
What does the 70s have to do with anything? I don't even know. What is
the political thinking. The political thinking when there was a white minority that was basically running everything.
Oh, that's what you're
trying to say. Okay. So I think there's a culture war going on right now in the United States. And, you know, the white majority is slowly understanding that they're losing power. Mm-hmm. If you look at the results of the election, Barack Obama won basically all the minority groups, blacks, of course, Latinos by a huge margin.
Mm-hmm.
He won the women vote. He also won the gay and lesbian vote.
Yeah.
And then also, if you notice, there's many states kind of taking they're taking things into their own hands in terms of changing some of the laws that are stifling people civically. For example, a couple more states have passed gay marriage rights.
Mm-hmm.
For individuals. We even had two states that actually came out and legalized marijuana, not even for medical purposes, but for recreational use. And so that just shows that there's a huge ideology shift in America. And I just think there's no way the Republican Party can fight against that. And if they want to remain relevant, especially with the next presidential election, they're going to have to change some of their views and kind of reach out to some of these minority groups.
Yeah. I mean, I think ideology shift or not, I mean, yeah, there's definitely things that are changing. But I still would say that for the most part, the ideology that was represented by the Republican Party's approach to how we deal with the nation's problems, as opposed to the Democratic approach to how we deal with the nation's problems. For example, taking this fiscal cliff as an example, I think still they're much too similar, much too similar.
That's not true. I mean, when you think about it, how did the fiscal cliff come about?
Once our currency was downgraded, actually.
No, that had nothing to do with
that
it.
That had everything to do with
no,
it.
No, it did
our
not.
Our currency was downgraded at the end.
Let
the fiscal cliff is before we
get
into
the discussion. The fiscal cliff was brought about. It's known as the fiscal cliff now. 2 years ago, and a lot of people who follow politics may remember this, but 2 years ago, there was a huge fight about raising the debt ceiling.
Because Moody's or Standard & Poor's had downgraded. We had a AAA rating. We went from a AAA rating to a double A plus rating, which sent everybody in a tiffy in Congress and basically punked the Congress into saying that we're going to have to pass this act now that says that we have to cut. And if the
not true,
and it's completely
that's
true.
Not true. You don't know what you're talking
okay,
about.
Okay, well, what
look,
happened?
This what is happened what happened.
Then?
The Republicans and the Democrats could not come to an agreement about raising
this was the. Before
let,
that.
Let's hear me out. Hear me
that.
Out. Hear
okay,
me
go
out.
Go ahead.
The Republicans and Democrats.
Can't wait till people come back with the comments after this show.
Listen.
Go ahead.
The Republicans and Democrats could not come to an agreement about raising the debt ceiling.
Yes.
The Democrats needed to raise it because Barack Obama needed to push these programs through. The Republicans said, no, we're going to hold this hostage, which has never been done before.
Right.
We're going to hold this hostage and threaten the downfall of the economy by holding the debt ceiling hostage. The fiscal cliff came as a result of that because they could not get or come to an agreement on how to handle it. They said, okay, I'll tell you what, we're going to push it forward now, but we have to come back to the table by the end of by the end of December of 2012 to come to a solution. And to force themselves into a solution, they basically created this what's called sequestration, which means automatically, if there's no deal struck by the end of this year, there's going to be automatic spending cuts across the board, and there's going to be automatic tax increases.
Yeah, $50 billion in defense and $700 billion in non-defense
right.
discretionary
exactly.
spending.
Now, the credit downgrading was a result of our politicians' inability to come to an agreement. It wasn't downgraded before that. It was downgraded as a result of that.
I don't know. I thought that the downgrading came first.
No.
And then after that,
no,
suddenly
didn't.
This what's called the budget control act was introduced to punk this Congress into going ahead and creating these austerity cuts across the board.
Right, that came first, which is why our credit was downgraded, because Moody's didn't have the confidence that our country's leaders can come together and fix this situation.
Everybody out there, when you find check out it. That actually the downgrade check came it. First before this inability. Anyways,
check it.
So then there was this committee that was established, 6 Republicans, 6 Democrats. They came together and they were supposed to say, okay, what can we come up with as an alternative to this sequestration that's going to go into place automatically? These, you know, this $1 billion worth of cuts. After a couple of months of deliberation, you know, they came out and they issued a statement saying, we can't come to a compromise right now. Sorry, I don't know if we're going to be able to make this compromise by the deadline. So here we are, a year later. This was a year later that they came out with the statement saying that this wasn't going to be able to happen. They came out, and now here we are trying to figure out what's going on. And there's rallies and stuff taking place. Obama was meeting with labor leaders all over in the White House today trying to figure out. Everybody's saying, well, my little side of it, let's not cut this, let's not cut that. And my point
is, realistic is that? How realistic is for anybody to sit and say, no, you're not going to touch my piece of the pie?
Why do we have to cut anything at all is what I'm saying.
Because you're in a deficit. That's why you.
So what?
If you get in debt with your own personal finances, are you going to keep spending?
What I'm saying is this. First of all, why do we have this arbitrary? Where did this deadline come from at the end of the year in January anyway?
We just explained that.
I know. But what I'm saying is, Who authored the Budget Control Act? I saw who introduced it in the House and then who introduced it in the Senate. One of them was introduced by a Republican in the House. One of them was introduced by, I think, a Democrat in the Senate. But it doesn't say who authored it. It just
why does it matter who authored it?
Because I want to know. And I want to know where this I want to know where this deadline came from and why it is that we don't have that we, the United States of America, and you know, our president can't say, no, well, if we can't come to negotiate this right now, actually we can. Let me actually just share something with you guys real quick. It should be real quick. But because this is really, here's the axiom that we've got to overcome. The idea that these cuts have to go through. This is why a couple of months from now? Why can't we figure out something else?
We'll get to that. I don't understand. Like what? What do you suggest?
That's a great question.
What do you suggest?
I'll address that after I let my friend, another shout out for a California representative, Maxine Waters. Let me let her say something real quick. Shoot, if I can find it. Hold on.
Well, listen, we're not going to sit here and let you ruffle through papers. We're trying to figure out what everybody needs to understand is that
here the fiscal is. Cliff, sorry,
the fiscal
Waters.
Cliff, and this is how it's going to affect you. Basically, your taxes are going to go back up.
He's scared of Maxine Waters.
Your taxes are going to go back up. I love Maxine.
He should be.
I love Maxine.
He's scared of what she's got to say on the fiscal cliff. He doesn't know that I'm about to bring this out. Okay.
Say what Maxine has to say.
Maxine. This bill repeals the provisions of the Budget Control Act, which she introduced as an alternative to the fiscal cliff. This was actually almost a year ago now. This bill, I don't want to start there. Starting here. I firmly believe that Congress should be focused squarely on the nation's unemployment crisis. Since the super committee's single charge is to produce $1.5 trillion in deficit reduction, which could include cuts to programs that create jobs, it must be promptly dismantled so that regular order can be restored and the federal government can fully dedicate itself to creating jobs and stimulating the economy. The committee, referring to the bipartisan committee of 6 Republicans and 6 Democrats.
Read the whole...
No, just one more sentence. The committee is an illegitimate shell game which poor and middle class Americans will lose. It flies in the face of basic principles of fairness and transparency. How can 12 people decide the fate of millions of Americans behind closed doors with little to no input from Congress or the average citizen? Last sentence. The 523 members of the House and Senate who do not serve on the super committee will be excluded from having the opportunity to present their constituent interest to the super committee's bill. Boom. I had to bring that up just because it was such a gem that I found. Yes, it is a usurpation of the, in my opinion also, of the responsibilities of the Congress. And where did this, why? Why right now? And why can't we figure out an alternative? But go ahead, you were going to say something.
No, I just don't. I mean, I see, fine. I like Maxine. She may be right about it. But the fact remains, we're still in this position. Okay?
Yeah.
We still have the fiscal cliff deadline on the 31st. There basically are no, the only alternative is to allow the fiscal cliff to happen.
No.
Which the upside to that, now it's going to hurt a lot of people if they, you know, create these cuts across the board. Defense, Medicare, Social Security, everything's on the table in terms of being cut. So it is going to affect a lot of people. The CBO, the Congressional Budget Office, has come out and said that if this fiscal cliff happens, it's going to send the economy into another recession because there's going to be loss of jobs.
Which makes how much sense?
But see, that's the point. The reason they did this was to force themselves to come up with an agreement. Nobody's going to allow this fiscal cliff to happen. Nobody.
Well, we'll see about it. But
so they did this to force themselves into an agreement, which was probably a smart play on Barack Obama's part, because now he just got reelected. He's been running on the premise that he wants to raise taxes on those making more than $250,000 a year.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, 65% of the people who voted for him, or of this country who voted on Election Day, agree with him. I mean, it's not a secret that most people agree with him that you should allow the Bush tax cuts to expire for people making higher wages. So he basically has boxed, or the Republicans have boxed themselves into a corner where they can't even, they can't oppose this now, because they're going to be seen as obstructionists.
I know there's been a lot of Republicans that have been coming out recently saying, oh, we're willing to make certain concessions. As long as you guys are willing to cut into the entitlements, too.
They have no choice.
But let me just address one thing before we have to go to commercial break. You asked me earlier, what can we do as an alternative, whatever. I'd say this. First and foremost, which also Borofsky agrees with me on, Neil Borofsky, who was, somebody who was investigating this whole bailout, who actually wrote a book about it. And people who know, it's, look it up. I can't go into that right now because there's never enough time. However, he said, re-implement something akin to Glass-Steagall. Separate the commercial banking from the investment banking, for starters. I agree with that, because the bailouts definitely are not getting to the population and to the banks that they were supposed to be capitalizing in the way that they were supposed to be, number one. That's a myth. Two, here's what I would do, especially right now. How many American citizens are still without electricity right now on the eastern side of the United States? How many?
I don't know.
I don't even know. I don't even have the latest statistic on me right now. I'm going to tell you, $50 billion in...
She's killing me, Richard.
This is an important day. Have you been watching the news, you guys? $50 billion, number one. I don't know how many people, but look, let's do this. Let's have a science driver program. $50 million is not that much money. Deploy people to fix the problems of the infrastructure, to feed our citizens who are still there without basic needs being met right now. Do like a real science driver push. Make that the example for the rest of the country. Employ hundreds of thousands of people in the productive
sector.
Millions of people in the productive sector.
It does not solve the problem of the fiscal cliff.
This will then pay into things like Social Security, things like Medicaid, things like Medicare, because they are employed. There's absolutely connection.
We got to take a break.
People are saying the entitlement programs are broken, but they're not broken. The problem is that people are not paying into it. We're going to take a break. We're going to also lengthen this. I'm running for office. I'm convinced.
We'll be right back. We'll be right back.
I was president. If I was president, yeah. I know some soldiers that sleep, but they can't dream. Wake up with screams.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Run, climb, play. Solgar number 7 can help. Feel the difference for yourself. Solgar number 7 actually shows improvement in joint comfort within 7 days. Now you can start to get back on track fast and pursue the activities you love. Solgar number 7 is a breakthrough in joint care with no glucosamine and no chondroitin. The advanced bioactives in Solgar number 7 help to increase flexibility, mobility, range of motion, and actually shows improvement within just 7 days. One capsule, once a day, is all you need. When stiff joints occasionally say no, Solgar number 7 says yes. Visit Solgar.com and learn more about Solgar number 7 today. That's www.solgar.com, www.solgar.com. Solgar number 7. Official sponsors of Here's to Your Health with Josh Lane, and LA Talk Live.
Oh, your skin looks great.
Thank you.
What's your secret?
Frankincense and myrrh oil by Ancient Essence.
Frankincense and myrrh oil by Ancient Essence?
Yes, it's a beauty secret used since the time of the Greeks and Romans. The spa in Malibu told me about frankincense and myrrh by Ancient Essence, and now my skin is lovely.
Well, your skin looks great.
Call Ancient Essence at 1-800-627-9813. Discover the secret of beautiful skin. Call 1-800-627-9813. Discover the secret. Frankincense and myrrh oil by Ancient Essence. Discover the secret of beautiful skin. Available at fine spas and beauty centers.
And we are back. We are
back.
It's James Brown.
I know.
What you know about James Brown?
Rocky IV.
That's before your time.
That's what I know about it from Rocky IV.
Rocky IV.
I know Dolph Lundgren from Rocky IV. I know Dolph, and I know this James Brown song.
Was there a Rocky IV?
Yes.
There was like eight of them.
No, that was the final one.
No, that was a five.
No, and six, actually.
I tuned out after the second one.
No, four was good.
We are back. Yes, we have our special guest with us, former Speaker of the California State Assembly and current managing partner for Mercury Public Affairs, Mr. Fabian Nunez.
Yay.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you so
you.
Much for
thank
joining
you for
us.
The great
today.
Applause.
Yeah, we've got a studio audience here, as you can tell. But thank you so much for joining us today. And we
happy.
Know that you must be pretty happy with the results of the election.
Yeah, you
Obama.
Did a lot of campaigning in the past election. You even wrote an op-ed in the Huffington Post that I got a chance to take.
Yes, I did. I'm ecstatic about the election results. I think they say a lot about the future of this country. And I think that remember in the first campaign, President Obama at the time, then Senator Obama, ran on a platform of change. And one of the things that he would talk about is, let's turn the page. Mm-hmm. And the ironic thing is that happened now.
Mm-hmm.
But if you look at, you talked a little bit about it earlier in terms of the electorate, the makeup of the electorate and the coalition that came together to reelect him as president, I think is very telling in terms of the future of this country.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It was amazing to see, you know, like we were saying earlier, that Barack Obama won pretty much all of the minority bloc in terms of the electorate.
Right.
Now, were you actually working on the Barack Obama campaign?
Well, I was beginning. The first of the year I started working, I was recommended by the campaign. They were looking at Univision, which is the largest Spanish language television network in the country, was looking for an expansion of their television coverage on the election, the
right.
2012 election. And so what they did is they reached out to all the campaigns and they said, okay, we want, you know, the best Spanish-speaking analysts on the Republican and the Democratic side. So they searched high, they searched low, and they couldn't find anyone, so then they reached out to me.
Oh, you were the last resort.
but I think that the Obama campaign had a lot to do with Univision bringing me on board. And you know, I mean, I've been interviewed by people. I've never been an analyst per se. Mm-hmm. And it's an interesting thing because you can give your opinion, you can give your perspective, and you're not held accountable for it.
Absolutely.
So it's different than being a politician.
Absolutely.
It's a lot better, actually.
Until you rerun.
well, until you run, and then the things you say, you can say, yeah, I said that, but if you listen to what I said the following week, it was totally different.
Yeah.
Oh,
so
then,
all that.
Ramnesia.
Well, one thing you definitely do have a reputation for is being somebody that can have create dialogue between the aisles.
Right.
And that was something that you worked very hard at when you were Speaker of the House and you had to work with Governor Schwarzenegger.
Right.
So just in your opinion, at this moment now, Obama got reelected. We clearly have still many disagreements between the parties, particularly right now with how we're going to deal with handling this fiscal cliff, as right. we also discussed. What are your thoughts?
Well, you know, it's really interesting. I listened to part of your conversation on this, but I mean, my sense is that it's going to get worked out. sometime, I think it was in the New York Times today, one of the members of Congress, you know, probably one of the most recalcitrant members in the House on the Republican side, said, you know, the reason why we didn't solve this before the election was because we had a presidential election. And now that the election is over, mm-hmm. certainly, you know, people are more willing to work together to get this done. Because at the end of the day, whether you're a Democrat or a Republican, an independent, and irrespective of your political party, people do get to Congress with the best of intentions. Mm-hmm. Obviously, that doesn't suffice
right.
in terms of being able to do all the right things. But I think at times like this, when you know that if you don't solve this problem by year's end, then, you know, our economy is going to essentially collapse. I believe that the solution to this is a lot easier than most people. But I think the right people are there. For example, the third ranking member on the Republican side of the House of Representatives is Kevin McCarthy, mm-hmm. old colleague of mine. Mm-hmm. When I was Speaker of the Assembly, he was Republican leader in right. the Assembly. He always wanted my job, but he wasn't going to get it.
Right.
So instead, he went to Congress. And interestingly enough, he's the third ranking highest member of Congress. And Kevin and I probably disagreed on 70% of the things, maybe 80. Mm-hmm. But we always looked for common ground. How do we work together? Mm-hmm. How do we get things done? And, you know, I'll give you one example mm-hmm. of what we did in California. I remember that year we couldn't get a budget. We needed Republican votes. I needed four Republicans in the Assembly, and we needed three in the Senate. And the way I was able to get the Republicans that year to balance the budget that ultimately would reduce the projected cut for students in colleges, community colleges, and the UC CSU system, mm-hmm. In addition to protecting home health care, mm-hmm. was I had to bite the bullet, and I had to agree to this boat tax, which was like this way that, you know, rich folks who buy boats along the coast have a way of it's kind of a scam. They take these boats, they move them to Mexico for 30 days or 60 days, and then they don't have to pay the tax on the boat, which mm-hmm. is like, if you can afford to buy a $300,000 boat,
yeah.
you know, why shouldn't you pay 3%?
Yet another loophole for those who have the money, basically.
Right. And it was sickening for me to agree to it, but compromise is really about making sure that all points of views are expressed.
Absolutely.
And everything that you do. It's right. like a piece of art. You know, if more than one person is painting it, then, you know, everyone has to have their own expression in mm-hmm. it, whether you like that or not. Mm-hmm. That's what democracy is about. So in our case, what I did that year was I did a budget and I gave them the tax loophole for people who buy boats, rich people. And, you know, folks in Orange County, I had a lot of fans in Orange County after we did that.
Right,
I was happy about it. But I'll tell you, and a lot of Democrats, certainly people on the left, were very angry.
Of course.
That I had done that. But it was the right thing to do. It was the smart thing to do, because at the end of the day, we met our overall objective, which is protect home health care for seniors and folks that are in need. But also to make sure that the cuts to the community colleges in the CSU UC system weren't as devastating as was projected by the governor. So given that, I think that, you know, coming after this election with the message that was sent to Washington, D.C., which is loud and clear, mm-hmm. you know, when you're looking at the collection of people who came together to reelect President Barack Obama. Mm-hmm. It's not easy for someone to get reelected president of this country mm-hmm. when you have unemployment rate that's close to 8%.
Right. Absolutely.
It's not easy.
Absolutely.
But at the same time, I think what people realize is that the division in our country is not just a racial division.
Right.
It's an economic division.
Absolutely.
Tax policy, economic policy is important. I'll give you an example. Mm-hmm. You know, when you have middle-income people that are one, two paychecks away from not being able to pay their mortgage. You know, you got 2 or 3 months of reserves, and you've got no money in a savings account, and you know, you're upside down on your mortgage.
Right.
You know, it probably doesn't sound really good that rich people get to benefit from a huge tax cut.
Exactly.
That mm-hmm. was instituted under the Bush era.
Exactly.
Right. So you're thinking, whether ideological or not, it'd be like, well, it's just on fundamental unfairness.
Right. Right. Right.
So this whole thing about Romney campaigning on a $6 trillion tax cut, which half of it, incidentally, would be concentrated in the top 1%.
Right.
Whether it's individual individual wealth mm-hmm. or corporate wealth. Mm-hmm. And so if you're a middle class family, whether you're a Republican, a Democrat, an independent, doesn't matter. You're thinking, wait a minute, why do I support this? Which is why in this election, you never had a real conversation about economic policy.
Right.
No, because, you did not. Right?
Exactly. In the primary, you did.
No, you didn't.
But in the general, you didn't.
No, you didn't.
So anyways, right. I think they'll solve it. The Republicans are not that dumb. They see the writing on the wall, and they say, look, We cannot continue to try to safeguard the interests of the very wealthy over their own constituents, because most of their constituents are not wealthy.
Absolutely. And that's what puzzles me about the Republican Party, with that they are standing tall to make sure they save the tax cuts or give more tax cuts to the wealthy, when most of the people that vote for them aren't wealthy. Now, granted, a lot of the wealthier people are Republicans, and I get that. But I don't know any wealthy person that is opposed to paying a little bit more to help the country out of this situation. And the fact that the Republicans would stand on that and fight tooth and nail for that, they've really damaged themselves as a party in terms of, you know, now they kind of have to rebrand themselves, because they're basically fighting amongst each other now and pointing the finger at each other. That nobody knows what direction they want to go philosophically. And they just seem to be in a whole rebuilding stage.
Yeah.
So what do you think their prospects are, especially if they don't take back the White House in 2016?
Well, I think because what's happened, if you look at the Republican campaigns and all the money that was spent in this election,
yes,
a total of $5 billion, like, wow, we historic highs.
Yes,
never had spent that much money in an election. Obviously, 60% of it came from the Republican PACs, but let's be 40% of that spent in a Democratic campaign. So, I mean, the money is there, and it speaks for itself. Mm-hmm. But I think that, you know, rich investors had a keen interest in this election, and it was about protecting their 14%. Return or tax on capital gains.
Mm-hmm.
That 14%, you know, to a couple thousand people in this country means, you know, hundreds of billions of dollars.
Mm-hmm.
So when President Obama says, I want to raise taxes to the wealthy, or I want to restore the tax rate, by the way,
mm-hmm,
to where it was when President Clinton was president,
right,
and take the tax rate up a little bit higher, as mm-hmm, well as capital gains,
mm-hmm,
I think people just start thinking, oh my gosh, this is a revolution. No, it's not a revolution. It's restoring,
right,
some kind of comity to the process, so that, you know, we have an economy that works for everybody, not just for the wealthy.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I must say, look, in my own case, you know, I'm happy to pay more taxes.
Right.
Under the Obama economic plan, his tax plan, I think I would probably pay, you know, somewhere in the neighborhood of $150,000 more.
Mm-hmm.
Under the Romney plan, I would have gotten a $225,000 a year tax break. Now,
right.
Would that
do
nice?
You need that?
I don't need it. Would I spend it? Absolutely.
I can use it.
I would spend it. But here's the issue. Here's the issue. And you think about it. How many more jobs am I going to create,
right,
from it? And it's a fallacy to think that if you put more money in the pockets of rich people, that ultimately more jobs
down.
are going to be created.
Yeah. Yeah.
Interestingly enough, this is the first election in probably the last two decades where a real conversation about economic policy never happened in the general. It happened in the primary,
yes,
where Republicans were racing to see who was going to protect the billionaires.
Mm-hmm.
But
mm-hmm,
when it got to the general,
mm-hmm,
if you notice, Mitt Romney became a moving target. He kept saying, "Well, yeah, I'm gonna make changes to the tax rate, but I'm gonna close all the loopholes. I'm gonna do." And it was
no
not
specifics.
Really clear.
Yeah,
it wasn't
no
clear
specifics.
What he was gonna do.
It was just mainly, you know, I can do it better than him, so hire me. You know,
and
it's crazy. Like, you wouldn't hire somebody for your business and then not, you know, follow up on them and make sure they're doing the job correctly. So, you know, I don't see how he thought that people were just gonna buy that. I just don't see that. So
let me ask this question, though, as a follow up from the previous answer that you gave before your second question. But just on the issue of compromising and on the issue of, you know, making certain concessions. When this is something I've been thinking about, just because I've been reading one of Kennedy's books, well, one of my favorite books right now, Profiles in Courage. I recommend it. Everybody go out and look at it. But how do you know when you're making a compromise that compromises principle, as opposed to a compromise that is something that is useful towards achieving a step in the direction toward achieving a goal? It's a tough question.
Actually, no. I think it's a fundamental issue having to deal with. Principle is a grounding that one needs to have in order to be in a situation where, particularly in governance, where you're going to compromise. In other words, there has to be a starting point, and it has to be a solid starting point. You know, people are very keen to politicians, and they like people, even if they disagree with him, they want a politician, he or she, that has a point of view. the importance of having a point of view and having principle and believing in something, whether you agree with it or not, is that's your starting point. In other words, that's where you stand. Mm-hmm. So let's say in my case, I went to the legislature and I said that I want to raise the minimum wage. That's like, I got to get that done one way or another. Now, in the process, did I have to pass some bills that Republicans liked that I wasn't very happy with? Maybe on public safety or something? Yeah. But the interesting thing about compromise, I believe, is that it starts from people really having a point of view, mm-hmm. and being able to articulate a vision of that point of view and a perspective of that point of view. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And then once you can do that, see, compromise doesn't happen in a vacuum. In other words, people don't just say, hey, by the way, I think it's black, I think it's white, okay, let's meet somewhere down the middle. Mm-hmm. It's really not the way real compromise works. Mm-hmm. The way compromise works is it's balancing interests, mm-hmm. and figuring out that at some point, and this is where I think a lot of times, you know, folks on the left, mm-hmm. You know, which that's where I came from, you know, when I got involved in politics. At some point in the process that, you know, when I was in the legislature, I said, eh, this guy is moving a little bit away from where we are because he's compromising. Well, the only way you can get anything done, and this is my point, mm-hmm. AJ, is the only way you get anything done is to compromise. Mm-hmm. Because unless you control 100% or a supermajority, in this case in the legislature, I mean, now they just got a supermajority here, right, in California.
Right.
Now, if I was speaker and I had a supermajority when I was there, California would be a totally different place than it is today. That's mm-hmm. a different situation.
Right.
But when you don't have, and you have to compromise with the other side, and the views of the other side are very different than yours,
right,
it's important to figure out how to give them a little,
right,
of
right.
the things that they want. Maybe not the most important things, but something so that you can accomplish the thing. And then the art of compromise mm-hmm. comes into play. In other words, then it becomes a question not of trade-off, but of figuring out how you can take your perspective and your issues and the things you want to advance and help them fit the constituents of those that disagree with you. How
now,
do you do that?
How do you navigate that, though? For example, in Barack Obama's case, obviously, he came in wanting to compromise. He even, you know, gave the Republicans a lot of the things that they wanted in certain bills. And it was still like they didn't want him to succeed in terms of creating some progress. So
right.
as a leader, how do you create that environment of compromise with people who just don't want to work with you?
That's the $64,000 question. Mm-hmm. In the case of President Obama, the day he got there and he started working with Republicans, he started reaching out to them. Mm-hmm. The Senate leader, I can't think of his
Mitch McConnell.
Mitch McConnell.
Yes.
Mitch McConnell said,
yeah,
publicly said, the number one objective of the Republican Congress mm-hmm. is to unelect President Obama.
Yeah.
In other words, we're going to be recalcitrant. Mm-hmm. We're not going to work with him. We're going to block any and all efforts that will make him look good so that he doesn't get reelected,
yes,
even if it means
the downfall of the
economy. Downfall of the economy. Absolutely. Of this country.
And it backfired on them.
And it backfired on him because this president, in my view, was extremely successful. Mm-hmm. If you just take one issue, healthcare reform, mm-hmm. the hardest thing to do. That's why it hasn't been done since the 1930s.
Right.
No, it is. I tried it in California and failed, incidentally. Mm-hmm. You know, you got to fail at something.
And
you know,
this is a Democratic state.
Yeah, it's a Democratic state. I tried it and I failed. I couldn't get a bill past the Senate, very similar to the president's health care bill. Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you, it is the most complex, the most difficult area of government to reform is mm-hmm. health care. Mm-hmm. It is huge that mm-hmm. he was able to do that, given all of the things that he was facing mm-hmm. And all the economic challenges that he was facing with Wall Street falling apart, with the banks, you know, a week away from shutting down. Mm-hmm. I mean, and that, as you say, Demetrius, the downfall of the economy. Really,
absolutely.
That's what it was.
Absolutely. Well, one of the things we discussed earlier in the discussion was the whole, you know, the changing of the electorate. And one of the purposes of our show is to, number one, get young people involved with politics, let them know it's okay to be involved in politics,
it's
and be
cool.
in the know,
yeah.
you know.
Don't
and
take me as a poster boy for coolness, but it is cool.
Both of you are cool.
I like to think so, yeah. you know. Don't let the glasses fool you, people. But
I'm corny.
We yeah, sometimes. what we'd like to do is kind of build some coalitions amongst yeah. the minority communities.
Right.
African Americans, Latinos, LGBT, Because we all still have a lot of you know, civil issues that we need to move past,
and a lot of things that we have in common more than you know.
Anything. Absolutely, and so one of the things we want to do is try to create these coalitions amongst these minority groups, and you know, you having the experience of building coalitions yourself, what can you suggest? What can you tell us about making that happen that would, you know, kind of make that easier for us to do?
You know, it's interesting because I think in this last election is a perfect creates the perfect platform for coalition building. And it's actually a great example of what a coalition is, because, you know, oftentimes people think a coalition is or alliances, mm-hmm. but alliances are weak, right? Alliances are strategic sometimes mm-hmm. in nature. Sometimes they're just, you know, they're advantageous. And so sometimes
and they can fall apart.
They can
like
fall
that.
Apart, yeah. right? An alliance. But this is not really an alliance. Mm-hmm. This is a coming together of people. And there's different things. There's different ingredients in that coming together. The most important of which is obviously there has to be a common thread. Mm-hmm. And the common thread is defined by the things that you support and the things you don't support. For example, in this last election, you know, all the Republican candidates going out there and talking about, you know, 100 years ago on women's issues, mm-hmm. reproductive rights, mm-hmm. you know, I mean, you name it, they were on the wrong side of it. And, right. and women were thinking like, what is this? You
right.
know, is this 1856
right.
or is this 2012?
Right.
And so I think that was a big issue, right?
I'm sorry, but just that one moment in the debate, in the last debate where he was like, yeah, you know, you have to take into account the fact that, you know, women are going to have to go home, they're going to have to feed the babies, they're going to have to feed yeah. the children, they're going to be flexible, damn it.
Yeah, she was so pretty sorry. Upset about just, that.
Well, no, or what about the time when we're talking about pay equity among women, and he says, oh, yeah, you know, I have a whole binder full of women, right?
Exactly.
Yes, right?
Yeah, you have a binder
right.
full of women
not
that
to
are
cut
qualified.
You off, but okay. It was
that
so
sounds more
ridiculous.
Like a pimp.
Yeah. I know a guy here in South LA that has a binder full, and another guy on the east side of LA that's got a couple
right.
binders. But you know, part of this is that common thread. So it's common threads are defined in politics are defined by the two main ingredients: that which brings you together, mm-hmm. and that which you agree on, and those things which you oppose. But it's a unifying force. So mm-hmm. you know, in this case, whether it was women's issues, whether it was on immigration issues for Latinos, you know, 71%, you know, the highest number ever for any president. Voting for President Obama, even though he's deported more people than any other president mm-hmm. in history, and it's very hard for me to accept the fact that that's happening mm-hmm. because I made my career, you know, in politics defending undocumented workers,
right,
and making sure that these people who are being taken advantage of by their employers and by different sectors of our society, you know, were treated with dignity and respect. And so for me, it's very difficult to see that, but I understood why it was happening. Mm-hmm. But that aside, 71% Latinos. Asian Americans, people don't talk about Asian Americans,
yes.
a smaller population and higher numbers than Latinos came out to vote for
yes.
President Obama. African Americans, I mean, the numbers are,
yes.
you know, off the charts.
Mm-hmm.
Women, young people between the ages of 18 and 23 years old. So you talk about this coalition. What elects presidents in this country are older white men and ultra conservatives.
Mm-hmm. Not anymore.
So that scheme is totally changing. So mm-hmm. now the question is, how do you keep something like that together? And what I think it requires people at all levels of government, mm-hmm. and not just in the not just in the government sphere, but in the social sphere and others as well,
mm-hmm.
is to be more participatory with that type of process.
Absolutely.
Case in point, you know, like I get, you know, and I don't want to pat myself on the back, but when I left the speakership. I knew, I studied the speakership. There had never been an African American woman.
Right.
And there had never been a Democratic woman ever to be speaker. There really had never been a woman speaker in the assembly.
Mm-hmm.
So I encouraged, you know, now Congresswoman Karen Bass to be
yes. mm-hmm.
to run for that post. Mm-hmm. And it took some arm twisting on my part and on former Speaker Willie Brown's part to convince her to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, and she and I are really good friends.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I can't think like, well, I did that, so I did my thing, you know, now that's coalition building. That is coalition building.
Right.
But coalition building is what you do every day.
Absolutely.
Is how we express ourselves, mm-hmm. you know, not just in terms of our own friendships, but also in terms of reaching out to people, understanding what people go through,
mm-hmm.
and being able to put yourself in other people's shoes, you know,
yeah,
so that whenever there's something happening, you know, in any particular community, that it shouldn't just be people of that ethnicity helping out. It should
right.
be everybody
exactly.
coming together.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's always refreshing to have, you know, political figures on the show like yourself who are doing wonderful things in terms of coalition building and trying to move this country forward. We had Isidore Hall on the show last weekend. I know you know Isidore Hall pretty well.
He's a good man. He's a good man.
He's another dynamic young professional.
I tell you.
But I wanted to...
A lot of promise in him, by the way.
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I really wanted him in Congress, you know, but...
Oh, yeah.
I don't make these decisions unilaterally. But if I could, I would.
Yeah, I think
he may not be over for him for Congress yet.
I don't think so. Nor for you. But we'll get to that in just a second. But anyway, could you give us a little bit about your background, how you got into politics, how old were you when you got into politics, and then maybe kind of tell us a little bit about what your political future may be.
Sure. No, I got into politics when I realized how my father came to this country is what made me think very seriously about politics. And my father came to this country first in 1953 as a farm worker under mm-hmm. the Obrero program, mm-hmm. and you know worked in the fields of California. And then
from where did he come from?
From Mexico.
Mexico.
From northern Mexico, mm-hmm. Sinaloa, Mexico. And then he brought my mom with him, and they both became legal residents. And I saw their plight in what they did and how much they struggled. And ultimately, my entire family moved to the States. Mm-hmm. Even though I was born in the U.S., I was raised in Mexico. And then by the time I was 8, we moved back to the U.S. Anyways, long story short, my father was a gardener, had 2 full-time jobs. My mom was a maid. And I had to go work with my dad on Saturdays and Sundays. And I just thought that was like the worst thing that you could do to a kid. You know, I want to wake up.
You're preaching to the choir here.
I want to wake up Saturday morning when I'm 7, 8 years old and watch cartoons like the rest of the kids. You know, when I'm 12, I want to go play baseball on Saturdays.
But instead, you're out in the field.
Soccer. Instead, I'm out mowing people's lawns in La Jolla.
He was in the tobacco fields.
Oh, that's I grew up in tobacco fields. And shout out to grandma and granddaddy. I remember that. Yeah.
So you connect. Every day. You relate.
I was watching TV.
Riding bikes.
But I tell you, it was a fundamental. You look at it as a kid and you think this is just fundamentally wrong. And I remember days, tears are just, and I wouldn't say anything to my dad, but the tears would come in. And I would just think, this is unjust.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. But ultimately, I started reasoning with it and understanding, well, the injustice wasn't so much my father. Mm-hmm. Then I realized, well, wait a minute. Why is he working 2 jobs and has to have this side business in the weekends? Mm-hmm. Then I realized his employer was paying a minimum wage. And then you make the connection. You think, you know what? It's a class issue. Mm-hmm. You know, and my father's being exploited. Mm-hmm. And that's why we have to go work and help him work. Mm-hmm. And that's when I started getting politically involved. By the time I was 14, 15, 16 years old, I was reading about politics. I was, you know, when C-SPAN first, I don't know if C-SPAN had been on, but I remember being in the 10th grade. Mm-hmm. I'm watching C-SPAN. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm living in Logan Heights in San Diego. You could hear the helicopters flying over you, the bullets, people shooting and running in the street and yelling. And I'm watching C-SPAN, mm-hmm. you know, thinking, oh, there's something these guys are doing there. I'm making decisions. They got to be affecting my neighborhood.
Right.
And I got to know about it.
Right.
You know, and that's really what got me to get involved, you know. So, you know, I define it as like I grew up around billboards and stray dogs and junkyards mm-hmm. mm-hmm. and sea smokes, you know, of the ships that were being built in the bay that I never got to see in San Diego, you know, because I didn't mm-hmm. even know I was by the bay. Mm-hmm.
Right.
But I think those are the kinds of things that, you know, just the real reality, not in a world that you live in, that you see it and you see your friends that are really smart. And their parents, you know, are having troubles and they're being raised by single parents. And you see the issues and the ills of the society that you live in and you realize, you know, there's something wrong, mm-hmm, you mm-hmm. know, because on the other side of the track, it's not like this.
Right, mm-hmm. right.
And so that's really what motivated me to get involved.
What was your first position in politics, or what was your first political position, you would say?
Well, my first political position was the UE, which is a union not affiliated with the AFL-CIO, mm-hmm. I got involved with them, and it was like the first job I ever had to go in and organize some factory workers, and they said during the summer of the 11th grade, and they said, you're going to work all summer, but in the last week of the summer, you're going to go talk to these workers, and I was the SALT, is what we're calling the SALT. Mm-hmm. You know, you go in there, mm-hmm. and they don't know you're with the union. You get to know them, and before you know it, you try to sign them all up. Mm-hmm. But what happened is after a week of being there, I was the guy with the staple gun stapling the furniture. And I was so sore. I couldn't move in the next morning. And I said, I can't wait a month before I'm going to start talking to these workers, you know, day one.
Right.
After
right.
about a week, I started organizing. And then, of course, you know, the owner of the factory identified me and I got fired. That was the first. That was my first real. My first. And that got me
starting trouble. Huh?
And that got me into it. And then from there, you know, I never got into this thinking that I would be in elected office because ultimately I got involved with the unions, and, you know, it was like a badge of honor to get arrested on a union picket line.
Absolutely.
You know, and my biggest one was I think it was in 89, LAPD, Century City, Justice for Janitors campaign. I was, I don't know, 20, 21 years old. Mm-hmm. I just moved to LA. And I remember moving, you know, a busload of people from my neighborhood in Pomona down to that thing. And it was a big rally, and the LAPD came out and they beat us with billy clubs.
Wow.
And I was pretty angry about that. And when mm-hmm. I came out and I said, okay, this is it. I got to do something more than this. You know, there's more that can be done. And so that kind of evolved. And by the time I ran for office, mm-hmm. you know, I had, I don't know, 8 arrests or something like that on my record.
Right, so right.
It didn't look good on paper.
Yeah.
But I think people in the district realized, okay, this guy, you know, he's
right,
okay.
Right.
He's
right.
not a criminal.
Right. Absolutely. And so your work with the unions is what eventually led you into the California State Assembly.
Yeah. See? Before I worked with the unions, I worked as an immigrant rights organizer. I was with One Stop Immigration Center. You know, at the time was a grassroots Latino organization that was organizing workers and, mm-hmm. and getting them into the fold to become legal residents. And I did that for many years. Kevin De Leon, who's now state senator, yes. he and I worked together in that organization. Juan José Gutiérrez, great leader. Mm-hmm. We organized a big march in 1994, 100,000 people in LA. I think that's what opened my eyes to the power of organizing. I mm-hmm. said, you know, this is really, really good. Mm-hmm. A couple years later, Gilbert Cedillo was the head of SEIU 660. Now, you know, running for city council, great mm-hmm. state senator, good friend, mm-hmm. Said, I need you to go to the labor movement and help me land a union job with the Utility Workers Union. And 2 years later, I was a political director of the LA County Federation. Mm-hmm. I don't know, it just happened really fast.
Right, right.
You know, 4 years later, I'm running for assembly.
Yeah.
I don't know, just, you know.
Yeah, things happen fast in the political world.
Yeah, right? And then a year later, I'm the speaker of the assembly. Right. Then I'm pitching myself thinking, wait a minute.
Right.
A couple years ago, I was getting arrested and getting, you know, billy club by police officers. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So my trajectory was very different. I don't recommend it for certainly for young people, because, you know, I think that you can skip past like the first 10 years of my involvement.
Yeah.
And my hope is for other people like yourselves and others is to not have to go through that.
Right, know? Right.
Absolutely. You get graduate from college, and then, you know, there's got to be a place for people, because, you know, there's only so much time we have in this earth. Mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. I think we got to make the best of it. And we got to, there's a lot of work to be done.
Absolutely. Absolutely agree. Absolutely agree. Well, and you're currently the managing partner at Mercury Public Affairs. Can you tell us a little bit about Mercury and what it does?
Yeah, Mercury is a private firm that does public affairs, public consulting. You know, it's a firm that has it's like a 14-year history. It's born out of New York City. Mm-hmm. 8 partners in the firm. I'm one of the 8 partners. We had 9 partners. At 1.12, we're down to 8. I'm the only Democratic partner now in the firm. There was 2 of us. Actually, there's me, and then there's Freddie Ferreira out of New York, mm-hmm. who was the president of the Bronx. So actually there are two Democrats. There was 3. Now there's 2. It's a good firm, and it's interesting because, you know, you have an opportunity to work with Republicans. I've always been comfortable around people. I don't care what nationality,
right.
what, you know, political affiliation, you mm-hmm, know, sexual mm-hmm. orientation.
Right.
I don't discriminate against anybody. I'll work with anybody. But there's interesting issues, because there are times where I don't agree with some of the things that the firm is working on, and I don't work on those things. So
yeah.
I work on the things I care about.
So what's next for you? Are you going to continue to be on the outside of politics and kind of being like a kingmaker, so to speak? Or do you want to kind of get back into the saddle and do some things politically in terms of elected office?
Well, you know, one of the things that's interesting about public office, if you look at just the last 10 years, in particular with Latinos and African Americans that are in office, people who typically run for office, you look at the Congress and the U.S. Senate, are folks who basically made a career. They're independently wealthy, and then they run for office. Mm-hmm. For people of color, it becomes the career, right? It becomes the career. Mm-hmm. And I think that there's both pros and the positive and negative to that. In mm-hmm. my case, you know, now that I'm independently, you know, self-sufficient, and mm-hmm. I don't feel that I want to be in elected office just yet. Eventually, I think I'm going to get back into it, only because I have the bug in me.
Right, right.
The weekend before the election, I saw President Obama. I had an opportunity to spend a little bit of time with him. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the first thing he said to me, he says, you're going to get back in, aren't you? I said, you know, Mr. President, I don't know. I'm really liking the private sector. I'm still involved in politics.
Right.
He said, no. You got the bug. You're getting back in.
Yeah.
At some point, I'll get back in. I don't know when. But I also don't feel like I need to be back in, because I think there are a lot of good people. Mm-hmm. that are passionate, mm-hmm. that are caring. But the one thing that I think is vastly needed in electoral politics if people that are gutsy, that are willing, that have the guts to take a stand
absolutely.
And to go for something and fight for something.
Definitely.
And not being afraid of failure.
Because
I can tell you in my case, I've had great successes and I have some big failures.
Right.
And I'm proud of both of them.
Right, right.
You know?
Well, without failure,
I'm not proud of all my failures.
Without failure, there is no success. Exactly. Though. So you have to fail at some things sometimes. But
And ideas, though. Don't forget about it. We have to have good ideas.
Oh, well, yeah. Without good ideas.
That goes without saying, but you just... Yes, I'm talking to the Congress right now.
Yeah, well, he always comes up with good ideas, and I'm sure he'll continue. So we look forward to what there is in store for you and your political future.
Good, thank you.
We'd like to tap you. Obviously, you know, like I said, some of the goals that we want to do here on the show is to, you know, create the coalition, get more young people involved. So we'd like to, you know, kind of tap you as sort of like a mentor in that aspect, if you don't mind taking on another mentee.
No, absolutely. I would love to be a part of your effort, and I want to congratulate you on doing this. I think that this is great.
Thank you.
However I can be supportive, keep me in mind and count on me 100%.
We really, really appreciate that. Right. Former California State Assembly Speaker, Mr. Fabian Nunez. Thank you so much for joining us again today, sir. And that's all the time that we have for today. We thank our guests for coming on. We'd like to remind everyone to follow us on Twitter at Demetrius and AJ, or you please like our Facebook page, Real Talk with Demetrius and AJ, so that you can keep up with everything that's going on. And anything else you have?
Nope, that's it.
All right, that's it for today. Make sure you join us next week for Demetrius and AJ.
You mess up the outro now.
I know, I'm going to get this right. Hold on. Okay. On behalf of Real Talk with Demetrius and AJ, this is Demetrius reminding you to be real.
And to be good. Okay. It's not that hard.
We got it right. We
see
got it right.
See you next time.
Take it easy.
It took him 5 hours, but we'll see you next time. Yeah. You're doing it too.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
If I were president, I'd make sure all the money spent on good things. I wouldn't have no land in my pocket. I rock it, I shock it. I would not jock the fact that there are rich people in the world, because, yo, I got a girl and she needs new clothes and I need new sneakers. And that's all I know. If I were president, if I were president. If I were president, I would not carry on no spare change. I would just rearrange the whole government structure, because there seems to be something that's messing with the fluxure of the money. It's not coming to me. So now it's time for me to tell my homie Jammer D. So I'm looking at my wallet and I do not have a buck.